Hi, today we will be presenting a new technique to automatically balance local exploration and computational efficiency in primary sample space. We are interested in rendering scenes with challenging radiometric properties, such as this aquarium with glossy and specular transport, as well as a classic Vigdor scene with complex visibility. The sparsity of contributive light paths makes this problem especially difficult, as only a tiny fraction of these paths actually contribute to the final image. Of course, you can use your good old Monte Carlo path tracer to render them, but you might run into some problems. To see why, it is convenient to see path tracing as a black box mapping from random numbers to light paths. Here, random numbers are generated in this so-called primary sample space U on the left. They are then warped and consumed by the sampling events that occur during path construction. This approach is conceptually simple, but fails to capture important regions of the space, as samples are generated independently from one another. This leads to uncorrelated light paths with effectively no knowledge of their relevance to the path integral we're trying to approximate. Veach and Guibas propose to leverage Markov chain Monte Carlo, or MCMC, to solve this problem. In short, the Metropolis light transport algorithm evolves correlated light paths using so-called mutation strategies, allowing an efficient local exploration of this high-dimensional space. Today, we will focus on the Simplify approach by Kelemen and colleagues, which operates in primary sample space. In this framework, the random numbers on the left are manipulated directly to propose new relevant paths, as opposed to moving the path vertices explicitly. To make this more precise, recall that PSSMLT starts by sampling a base path, here depicted in blue. This path is then modified by a perturbation, and a new candidate path is proposed, here shown in orange. Based on some acceptance criterion, this candidate is either accepted or rejected, and the process is repeated. This is a fairly straightforward application of the popular Metropolis-Hastings algorithm, but choosing imputation that can guarantee both local and global exploration of the state space remains an open problem. To illustrate why this is important, let us consider the following 2D example. Suppose the target distribution we are trying to sample, here denoted by pi, looks something like this, with a flat region on the top left and a narrow band on the bottom right. It would be tempting to use a medium-sized mutation over here to decrease the autocorrelation of our Markov chain. But the same transition somewhere else would suffer from slow mixing and low acceptance rates, as most candidate paths would fall off the high-density band. This would lead to chains getting trapped, producing undesirable splotchy visual artifacts in the image. There are a few alternatives to tackle this problem. For instance, using a more intricate and specialized mutation could improve local exploration, but at the cost of a potential higher running time. And while adapting the shape of the proposal along the chain is possible, doing so naively could break the conversion guarantees of MCMC. Therefore, one has to be careful when designing new adaptive mechanisms. So given the high-dimensional nature of light transport, it is clear that there's no such thing as a one-size-fits-all mutation. On one side, simple mutations offer limited exploration capabilities, but they are cheap to sample from, so more can be performed within the given time budget. On the other side, locally adaptive methods such as the Hessian-based approach by Lee and colleagues, and a more recent work based on launch band diffusion, presented this year at SIGGRAPH, excel at capturing the local shape of the target density. However, they are typically more expensive to perform, so using them everywhere may be wasteful. In this paper, we introduce a new proposal mechanism to automatically balance these two trade-offs. And the intuition behind our approach is fairly straightforward. When you fail, try something else. And to be more concrete, successive rejection indicates that the proposal is not well calibrated. We suggest to augment the proposal with a second but different mutation as a safety net to the first. The result is an expressive two-stage strategy that attempts more risky moves only when needed, while keeping its costs relatively low. We propose to use the delayed rejection MCMC framework to achieve this in a principal manner. But before diving into the core of our approach, let's take a step back and look at the crux of all MLT-based techniques, the Metropolis-Hastings algorithm. So given a current state X, a new state Y is sampled from a mutation Q, also known as a Markov transition kernel. And we intentionally leave this Q undefined for the time being. This new state is then mapped to a light path, and an acceptance criterion is checked in order to decide if we move to Y or stay at X. In essence, Metropolis-Hastings establishes acceptance probabilities that are carefully designed to satisfy detail balance. This is just to say that paths will eventually be distributed according to the overall contribution to the final image. So if we peek into this acceptance probability, we see a relatively simple test. where we have a ratio of target densities. For instance, this could be a function of the luminance of our light paths. And we also have a ratio of transition kernel densities. And the minimum here is just so that probabilities don't exceed 1. Now, suppose we would like to support consecutive proposal within a single Markov iteration. This is an important detail because we cannot simply change the transition kernel on the fly without breaking the reversibility constraint. Imposing different stages must somehow be accounted for in this acceptance ratio. Delayed rejection MCMC provides a mathematical framework to do so directly. Here, the first stage is proposed using a normal Metropolis-Hastings step. So we just start from some x, propose a y using a first transition kernel q1, and then we just check. In this case here, the path bounces off the sake glass and cannot reach the lamp. It is therefore rejected. Instead of starting over, we can use a second mutation strategy to sample a third stage z from a different transition kernel q2. Since this mutation strategy is hopefully better tuned to those chain local needs, it is more likely to result in a high contribution light path. Another Metropolis-Hastings test must be performed, and if it succeeds, we can jump to Z and continue the chain as usual. Now, what we're really interested in here is the second MH step that determines the acceptance probability of moving from X to Z. If we look at this in more details, we get this very daunting equation. And while it may look scary at first, it's actually quite easy to understand. So let's do this. On the left, we have a simple MH criterion to support the second stage. This is what you're used to if you drop the condition on y, and in fact, when q2 is symmetric, the second half just becomes 1. We also have some extra bookkeeping to do to account for the first stage rejection. And really here, this is just a kernel ratio times the probability of rejecting the first stage, so nothing too fancy. What's really happening here is that we are greedily imposing detail balance at each stage, such that the overall procedure also admits this property. Now, as with a lot of things in rendering, the devil lies in the details. If we look at this ratio over here, then there's nothing that indicates that it should cancel out, because the states are different, even if q1 is symmetric. We have to compute it somehow, which can be expensive. And even worse, it can drag the whole acceptance towards zero if the numerator is not well behaved. To see why, consider a naive application of delayed rejection to PSS-MLT. Let's say we start with some state x, and we use the popular Kelemen-style mutation here in blue, which has exponential drop-off as well as a zero-density hole that loosely encourages stratification. Now suppose that some y is proposed and rejected at the first stage. We then move to the second stage and use a different transition kernel q2 to sample a new state z. If we try to compute the acceptance probability of moving from x to z, we'll face some issues. Evaluating the denominator here certainly works since y was originally sampled from q1. However, we must also evaluate the numerator, which now involves the probability of moving from z to y. And when z is too far away from y, we might end up falling in the tail of the kernel distribution, or worse, in a region with zero density. Even if we were to use a kernel with global support, the ratio would still be too small. This turn will dominate the acceptance at the second stage, and we'll have traced this new path for nothing. In the paper, we refer to this problem as the vanishing acceptance at the second stage. There's an existing solution to this called the generalized delayed rejection algorithm, which proposes to use an intermediate state y star to circumvent the need to evaluate the ratio. To be brief, this approach simply makes sure that the distances are kept equal so that the densities are the same. The problem with this approach in our context is that this new state y star needs to be traced to a path. Moreover, this framework doesn't directly allow us to accumulate the contribution of y star into our Monte Carlo estimate. So we must pay the full cost of tracing a light path just to get rid of our ratio.
Inspired by this, we propose what we call orbital mutations, which allows us to achieve more or less the same performance as the generalized framework without the cost of an additional tracing operation. So let's take a step back to where we were after rejecting the first stage. Our key observation is that isotropic mutations are actually just functions of differences. So if we constrain z to lie on the orbit that keeps this distance constant, then we won't have to worry about our ratio anymore. In the paper, we propose to do so using a wrapped Cauchy distribution, but really any circular and symmetric distribution will do the trick. What's nice about the Cauchy distribution is that it admits a closed-form expression for its CDF, so we can simply invert it for sampling. After sampling, we obtain some Z which lies at the same distance from Y. So, by construction, our ratio becomes 1. In practice, we do this pairwise and sequentially for simplicity, which roughly correspond to perturbating directional samples at each vertex. So, since our problematic ratio is now 1, and that the circular distribution is also symmetric, we get a trivial acceptance probability that doesn't depend on any transition densities anymore. Here, the R symbol just means maximum. If we compare the different delayed rejection technique on the glass of water scene, we see that our approach offers a significant win at equal render time. The original DR frameworks often get stuck, while the generalized framework fails to explore the tiny air packet in the water due to the extra tracing operation. Our approach offers a nice trade-off, as shown by a lower relative mean square error and smoother insets. To summarize our approach, we note that the original DR framework has a vanishing acceptance problem when applied to primary sample space MLT. There are two possible solutions. You can use the generalized DR framework, but you should only do so when the first stage mutation is much cheaper than the second stage. Otherwise, the extra tracing operation will not warrant its use. The second solution is to use our pairwise orbital mutations, which has no extra cost and is easy to implement. We implemented delayed rejection atop several primary sample space algorithms using two paradigms. The first one is a bold-then-timid application, which uses the original framework combined with our orbital mutation. The second one is a cheap and expensive application, which uses the generalized framework to follow a simple move by a more robust and expensive proposal. In all of our experiments, we report the median of multiple runs at equal time using the relative mean square error metric. Moreover, the all parameters are set to match the acceptance rate between the different methods to ensure a fair comparison. Finally, all methods are built atop a variation of multiplex MLT, where the bidirectional strategy is kept fixed along each Markov chain for simplicity. For more results and metrics, please refer to our supplementary material. As a first application, we demonstrate our bold-then-timid approach. Here, our goal is to balance global exploration and local exploitation. In multiplex MLT, a full path is created from the connection of two subpaths traced from the sensor and emitter, respectively. In the first stage, we mutate both the emitter and sensor subpaths using Kelemen mutation to encourage global exploration. If the first stage is rejected, it means that we might not be exploring the target at the right scale. We thus proceed to a more conservative second stage, where we only mutate the sensor subpath using our orbital mutation. Since this mutation acts on a lower dimensional subspace of PSS, we refer to it as timid. We implemented our technique in Mitsuba 1 and tested our bold-then-timid application against this aquarium scene. We compare our delayed rejection application against two vanilla applications of Metropolis-Hastings to light transport. The first one uses the usual Kelemen mutation, and the second one uses an equal mixture of a large and a small isotropic Gaussian that tries to mimic the delayed rejection exploration scheme. Here is a false visualization of the error map for the baseline algorithm. We can immediately see that this simple kernel cannot resolve the multiple scale of exploration needed in this scene. Using an equal mixture of two kernels helps, but it is still blind to the current needs of the chain. Our delayed rejection algorithm, leveraging the orbital mutation approach, reduces the overall variance, as shown by a lower error around the base, the teapot, and the fish tank. I'll flip between the two. Mixture, Rs. Mixture, Rs. To better understand the performance of our approach, we also visualize a relative acceptance map where violet and yellow extremes respectively indicate the efficiency for the first and second stages. As expected, we see that our method managed to adaptively fall back to the better suited mutation only when needed. In this scene, this corresponds to most of the space except the back wall and the front of the table. We next demonstrate our cheap and expensive approach. Here, our goal is to balance computational cost and local exploitation. During the first stage, we try an isotropic mutation such as a small Gaussian kernel. If it fails, we fall back to on a more specialized and expensive mutation strategy. Here, we use the Hessian-based anisotropic Gaussian mutation proposed by Lee and colleague. Since this proposal is more expensive than the isotropic mutation, and since the anisotropy is not shared, it's shared across several dimensions of PSS, we have no other choice than to use the generalized DR framework. We implemented our technique into the differentiable path tracer from the original H2MC algorithm. Again, we compare against two standard applications of Metropolis-Hastings. The first one uses a small isotropic Gaussian mutation, and the second one uses H2MC. Here is the standard PSS-MLT with isotropic Gaussian kernel. As you can see, it has difficulties in sampling the leftmost chess pieces, which are made of brushed glass. On the other hand, the anisotropic kernel is able to reduce the error in this region, but suffer from slow convergence and higher noise elsewhere. This is mainly due to the computational overhead of sampling a multivariate Gaussian at every step. Here's our cheap and expensive approach. Our method manages to obtain the best of each stage everywhere in the scene as shown by the lower overall variance. I'll flip between the two for comparison. H2MC, ours. H2MC, ours. Again, we see that the DRMLT algorithm only relies on the second stage in difficult regions of the scene, shown in yellow. To conclude, we list some limitations of our approach and potential avenues of research. First, our method cannot be directly applied to path space MLT. Since path space mutations are designed for paths with specific structures, choosing a kernel combination that is both general and suitable is difficult. Perhaps an inverse mapping approach could be a viable strategy to tackle this problem. Secondly, a combination of our approach with Langevin MCMC and H2MC could be a way to further improve the efficiency of both methods. Finally, it would be interesting to apply the related delayed acceptance algorithm to light transport. In short, this technique uses a cheap approximation of the target density at the first stage to filter out uninteresting samples. It is then followed by a second correction stage that tests against the true density. In conclusion, we have presented a two-stage approach to primary sample space that offers a wide range of applications. We showed that the original delayed rejection MCMC framework has a vanishing acceptance problem. And we propose a novel orbital mutation to confront this issue directly within the delayed rejection formalism. Our derivation gave an acceptance criterion that can be efficiently evaluated within a path sampler. As such, our method is easy to implement atop any PSS algorithm with minimal code modifications. So, to summarize, I'll talk in one sentence. Having a safety net can help exploration, and you should give it a try with your favorite PSS algorithm. And with that, we thank you for your attention. If you have any questions, please join us at the Q&A session, and our papers, its supplementary material, and the code base are all available at the address below. Thank you.